So there's plenty of things to be anxious about and concerned about if you watch television free-to-air news. Now I do it, but I'm aware it's not necessarily the best thing for me, because the other night I was watching it, and within the first half hour there had been 6 crises and 2 tragedies that they had reported on. And you see, the news media do this deliberately, because a long time ago they realized that bad news is better than good news in terms of holding people's attention. And so if they can continue to run out sort of crisis after crisis and tragedy after tragedy, it's better for the advertisers, because people stay and watch. But it does mean that you can get a bit overwhelming. So for the moment, if you just watched the news last week, I picked up, there's the cost of living crisis, there's the mortgage crisis, there's the housing crisis, there's the Medicare crisis, there's the Ukraine crisis, the environmental crisis, the youth crime crisis, and then whatever particular crises they had for that particular night. And then you add in the tragedies and the absolute tragedies and the absolute tragedies. And the tendency can be that you get to the end of the news story and you think the world is a pretty horrible place, and you can be pretty pessimistic, and you can be pretty down in the dumps of it. And there's a whole range of factors feeding into this, and television news is one of these, but there is an outworking of that in terms of mental health. And if you go to most people in the street today and say, you know, is the world getting better or getting worse? Most people say it's getting worse. And related to that probably is the issue of mental health in Australia. So we had the 2021 census, which was in the middle of COVID, admittedly, but in the midst of that, 2 million Australians, about 10% of the population, indicated that they had a mental health issue at the time of the census. And it was usually anxiety or depression. And sociologists have long acknowledged now that Australia is marked by those two things. People are anxious and people are depressed. And so how do we respond to that? I mean, some of us here this morning are probably feeling a little anxious. Some of us here are feeling some issues of depression. So the church people are not immune from the mental health crises that is affecting Australia. And so how do we respond? And how do we respond to those around us who are experiencing mental health issues, anxiety, particularly anxiety and depression, because particularly young people, the research says it's the young people who are really feeling it. And so how do we respond? And it's great to know that, as always, the scriptures have guidance for us here. The Bible, God's word to us, his gift to us, has guidance for us as we seek to respond to this challenge. And it's actually in the book of Romans, which we're going to look at this morning. And you might know that the Apostle Paul wrote this letter about 2,000 years ago to a place, a community, a church, or a number of churches he had never been to. Paul didn't plant the church in Rome like he did lots of other churches through Europe. But he wrote to them, and in this book that we've got in our Bible now, there's probably 3 reasons he wrote to them. The first was he had never been there, and he was the apostle to the Gentiles. And he's hearing that this church is, and all these churches in Rome are growing and flourishing. And so he wants to communicate to them his theology. He wants to make sure that their understanding of the gospel is the same as his understanding of the gospel. Second reason Paul probably wrote to the Romans was he wanted to visit there on his way to Spain. So God had laid it on his heart to take the gospel to Spain, and it's a long way and very difficult traveling, and so he wanted to do a stopover in Rome, and he wanted to introduce himself and say, "Hey, I'm Paul, this is what I believe, this is what I've got in common with you, I'd like to stop over on my way to Spain." But the third reason that Paul wrote to the church in Rome, and probably or possibly the most important reason, is what we're interested in today, is that there was a bit of a crisis in the church in Rome. They were going through a difficult time. And so a little bit of history now is that at Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came upon the church, there were probably Jewish people who lived in Rome at Pentecost. They received the Holy Spirit, they became believers, and these Jewish Christians went back to Rome and started a church. It's a great that's establishing and flourishing over there. But what started to happen was that Gentiles started to become believers as well. Non-Jews began to become Christians as well. And so for a while, this church was composed of Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. But in about the turn of the century, there was a lot of conflict in Rome in the Jewish community, and the emperor expelled all of the Jews from Rome, including the Jewish Christians, and they had to leave Rome, which meant that the church in Rome was then only composed of the Gentile Christians, the non-Jewish Christians. And they flourished and grew, and they developed their own way of being Christians, their own style of church and all of those things. And then eventually the embargo was lifted and the Jewish Christians could come back to Rome. And when they came back to Rome, they weren't all that pleased with what had happened to the church. It had changed. It wasn't like them. It wasn't as Jewish as it had been when they had left. And it had started to cause tensions. And news of this conflict had come back to Paul, and Paul writes this letter to them to explain how they're all saved by the same faith in Christ, the same Saviour, even though they were Jews and Gentiles, Jews and non-Jews, they were all saved by the blood of Christ. Now, when you read the book of Romans with that understanding, it makes a whole lot more sense, particularly chapters 9 to 11. If you know the book of Romans and you've read it and you've got to that bit where Paul goes on and on again on about the relationship between Jews and Gentiles in Christ, it makes a whole lot more sense. But here is where it gets hopeful for us. Paul is writing to a group of people who have a sense of crisis, a bit like the sense of crisis that we might be experiencing in our worlds today. And it was a sense of crisis that had affected their church. And I don't know if you've ever had the really unpleasant experience of having a crisis in a church, but it's really awful, isn't it? It's because often our workplaces or our families or our communities are full of ugliness and conflict and crisis. And we come to church and we find, you know, peace and joy and harmony and all those good things. But when church begins to be a little bit like that, when there is conflict and when there is crisis and when there is disagreement that's not managed well, even our church becomes something that doesn't give us that great sense of peace. And sometimes the outcome of that is anxiety and depression as well. And so Paul feels that pain, and so he's written this epistle to them, he's written this letter to them, and it's full of all of this theological truth. You know, that you're all one in Christ, the laws and explaining all of the food laws and circumcision and these things. He's saying you're all one in Christ, and he does that up in the first 12 chapters. But then in chapter 13 or chapter 15, he gets pastoral. He says, okay, here's the truth. I want you to go away and think about this truth so that you can live together in peace and harmony as a unified church. But now I want to pray for you. And that's what we want to look at particularly this morning. It's in Romans chapter 15, verse 13. So it was going to be on the screen, but it's in your Bibles. So if you've got a phone there, you've got a Bible, have a look at Romans chapter 15, verse 13. Just looking at one verse this morning, and this is what it says. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and all peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So he starts there by saying something really surprising. May the God of hope. Now, you've probably heard the Bible mentioned before, you know, that God is light, God is life, and the big one, God is love. But here Paul reveals that God is not only light and peace and love, he is the God of hope. He's not the hopeful God. It's a defining characteristic. This is one of the things that is the essence of God. He is a God of hope. You see, the Greco-Roman world was pretty hopeless. The ancient Greek philosophies, which dominated the world in which Paul lived, didn't give you much hope for life or for death. And so when Paul writes to the Thessalonians, he says, you don't live as those without hope. And he's referring to the Greeks and the Romans, who he basically had, have you heard the Stoic approach to life, which is just, you just stiff up a lip. Life is going to be miserable. You might as well just get used to it and go along with the flow. And in contrast to that, our God is the God of hope. Now, if you don't know that God, you've got to find your hope somewhere else. And usually in Western society, places like Australia, we look for hope in money. We hope that if we have enough money, that if something goes wrong in our life, we'll have enough money to be able to get along okay. So that is our source of hope. Alternatively, we hope in our bodies, that if we exercise enough and eat well enough and if we have good health care, that our bodies will hold on, and that's our source of hope. But hopefully you've been around long enough to realize that money and our bodies are not worth putting our hope in ultimately. Our hope needs to be in something bigger and stronger and more permanent than that. And our hope is in God. And so may the God of hope fill you. Now that word fill is a word used to describe the sail of a boat which has caught the wind. And if you've ever been sailing, you've probably had that exhilarating moment where, you know, you're sort of jiggling around trying to get the rudder in the right place and get the right angle on it, and all of a sudden the sail catches the wind and the boat takes off across the water. That's a beautiful image, isn't it? That may the God of hope fill us, breathe into us all hope, all joy and peace. And notice it's all peace or all joy. It's not just joy in church life or joy in having children or grandchildren. It's joy, all joy in all parts of life. And it's deep joy. It's not a trivial joy. It's not that giggling type joy. It's a deep joy that lasts. And look at that. It's a joy that comes when your PowerPoint screen returns. Well done, guys. Yes, give them a round of applause. They'll need a good lay down and relax after this. But yeah, so we've got all joy. And if you've been around a church long enough, you've probably met people like that who've got this joy, you know. And it's not just superficial; it's deep and in all aspects of their life. And I remember when I was pastoring, there was a lovely old lady who was just full of joy all the time. But then she developed dementia, and she declined fairly quickly and was put in a nursing home some distance away from the church. And so I didn't get to visit her that often. But one time I went to visit her, and I was just delighted as we sat and chatted, and the joy was still there. You know, even though a lot of the faculties are gone, the joy was deep. And the greatest, most joyous moment was when, after a while we'd been talking, she took my face in her hands, and she looked in my face and said, you're a lovely young man, but I've got no idea who you are. But that's okay. And the joy was still there, and the joy kept through. And that was the joy that came from God. All joy, deep joy. And that also that you'll be filled with all peace. And many of you will know that the English word peace doesn't capture the full richness of the Hebrew and the Greek concept of peace that Paul's talking about here. For us, peace is just the absence of war. But peace, or the Hebrew word shalom, is is the richness. It's about the flourishing of life. It's the way that life is meant to be. And so you would greet one another with, you would wish them shalom, you would wish them this peace. And again, it's not this superficial, oh, everything's okay. It's a deep peace that Paul is wishing that his readers would experience. And again, you meet different types of, you meet Christians who have it. You know, that when, no matter what the circumstances are, it's a bit like the joy, you know, like joy is, the biblical joy, Christian joy is independent of circumstances. You can have good times, bad times, the joy's still there. You can have turmoil, all sorts of things going on around you, but the sort of peace that Paul is praying for the Christians at Rome is in the midst of their church crisis, that they would have deep peace, the sort of peace that transforms life, an unshakable peace. And this comes as they trust in him. The Greek word that's translated as trust is sometimes translated as believe, but the belief is falls short of capturing what Paul's saying here. You see, there's a difference between belief and trust. Take the seat you're sitting on. Before you sat on it, you might have believed that the seat would carry your weight. But it was only when you sat on it that you put your trust in it. And it's one thing to believe in God. It's another thing to trust in God. It's one thing to believe in God, but when you actually begin to act on that belief, that is when you move into the realm of trust. And that's what Paul is saying here, that you, the God of hope will fill you with all joy and all peace as you trust in him, as you live in light of what you believe about God to be true, and as you have confidence. You see, hope is ultimately a matter of faith. Our hope is dependent upon whether we really trust God. And this is where the sharing of stories is so important, that I can share my story of faith with you and that it will help you to trust, and that you can share your story of faith with me and it will help me to trust in this God who is the source of all joy and all peace and all hope. Now, that's a lovely prayer, and Paul probably could have finished it there. You know, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. Amen. But that's not the purpose of the hope that we have, is it? So that you might overflow with hope. It's another image of a spring. I drove past a water main that had burst underground, obviously, and the water just bubbling up and out. And that's the image. That we would be so full of the hope of God that it's just bubbling up, and those around us get wet by it. Those around us get touched by this hope that is bubbling up from within our lives. And then Paul points out ultimately that this is a supernatural thing. We can't sustain that by ourselves. We need the Holy Spirit to be working within us to bring this hope and joy and peace that does overflow to those around us. And Paul talks about the Holy Spirit a number of times in the book of Romans. It's in chapter 5, it's the way that the love of God is poured out in our hearts is through the Holy Spirit. In chapter 8, he says, the Holy Spirit sets us free. And here in chapter 15, he says, it is the Holy Spirit who causes hope to bubble up and overflow abundantly, exceedingly, as some of the translations put it, to those around us. As Christians, we're meant to be characterized by many things. We're meant to be characterized by love, by faith, by joy, and by peace. But Paul's saying here that we are also meant to be characterized as people of hope. It's one of our defining characteristics. Apparently drug dealers are usually drug addicts themselves, and they sell the drugs to sustain their habits. Well, perhaps if I push the image a little bit here, we are maybe meant to be hope addicts. And not just hope addicts, but hope dealers. We are so hooked on hope that we like to sustain the habit by spreading hope around as well. And we don't sell it though, we give it away. People of hope. Because hope is the recognition or the allowing of the inbreaking of the resurrection of Jesus Christ into this world. It's through hope. You see, if Jesus Christ rose from the dead, anything is possible. And so Christians are characterized not by pessimism, but by hope, because Jesus has risen from the dead. And so Christians should be the half glass full people in any situation. When everybody else says that person is hopeless, the Christian should be the one who says, no, there is hope for that person. When everybody else is saying this situation is hopeless, the Christian is the one who says, hang on, Jesus rose from the dead. There's hope. There's hope in this situation as well. And there's perhaps no more important time for us to be people of hope, except in a world like Australia at the moment, where people have run out of hope, where our society is marked and our communities are marked, and particularly our young people are languishing in a pool of hopelessness. They are caught up with anxiety and depression, and they desperately need hope. And God calls us to be overflowing with hope in our contexts so that we can be Christ's messengers in that place. Many of our non-Christian friends and relatives have gone down the journey of secularism to the very end of the road and realized too late that it is shallow and empty, shallow and weak. They desperately need the hope that we have, and hopefully will be bubbling up from within inside of us. We are to be the glass half full people. You might have heard the story about a couple who had two twin boys, and one of them was an outright optimist and the other one was an outright pessimist. And the twins were going, their extremes on this matter were getting so far, the parents were getting quite concerned. And so again, somehow we've got to address this. We've got to moderate the pessimism and the optimism. So Christmas came. And on Christmas Day, the pessimist boy wakes up and his room is full of toys. And the parents are hoping, you know, all his toys, maybe they'll give him joy and hope. And he opens his eyes, smiles for an instant, and then bursts into tears. And they say, what's wrong? And he says, oh, what happens if I start playing with them and they break? So they sigh and go into the next room. And they've got this big mound of manure, horse manure, in the boy's bedroom of the optimism. So hopefully to, you know, moderate his optimism a little bit. But the boy wakes up, opens his eyes, screams in delight, climbs to the top of the pile of manure and starts digging through it. And they say, what are you doing? And he goes, with all this horse manure, there's got to be a pony in here somewhere. And we Christians are meant to be the manure diggers. That in any situation, we're looking for hope because we believe in hope and we believe God is doing things in this world. And if Jesus rose from the dead, anything is possible. Sadly though, as I said, sometimes in churches, we lose that hope. And William Barclay tells the story of a church that was facing a bit of a crisis. And at the beginning of the church meeting where they were going to discuss the crisis, the pastor prayed and acknowledged that God was the sovereign God who controlled the universe and that we rest in your hands. Amen. And then turned to the congregation and said, oh, we're in the middle of a crisis and there is nothing we can do. And sometimes we lose the joy. Sometimes we get the pessimism. Sometimes we become the prophets of doom instead of the heralds of hope. Let's not be like that. Let's be the people of joy, the people of peace, the people of hope in every context. Viktor Frankl was a survivor of the Auschwitz concentration camps during the Second World War at Auschwitz, and he wrote a book on life in the camp and how people survived. And he sort of noticed there was two groups of people. There were those who lost hope, and he said he used to be able to see the death in their eyes, that when they had lost hope, he could see the darkness in their eyes. And those who lost hope died in the camps because it was just too extreme. But he said there was the other group who always had the glimmer of hope in their eyes. They always kept hoping, and they were the ones who survived the camps. And in his book, he writes, "Everything can be taken from a man but one thing, the last of human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way." Let's choose hope. Let's choose peace. Let's choose joy in every circumstance. In another place, Paul talks about hope. And end of 1 Corinthians, he says, "These three things remain: faith, hope, and love." And the greatest of these is love. But hope is still there in the top three, to be one of our defining features. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for Jesus and the inbreaking of your power and hope into this hopeless world. And Father, we thank you that you have given us hope, that we don't live as those without hope, but we are touched by, through the power of your Holy Spirit, supernaturally transformed. And there is that potential for us to be full of peace and joy, and to be overflowing with hope to those around us who need that hope so desperately. And we pray for our church, and pray that pray the Grove will be known as a place of hope. And Lord, we pray for our non-Christian friends and relatives who don't know you, and pray that they will find your hope, and that our hope will overflow into their lives, that the joy and the peace, the supernatural joy and peace that you give to us, will overflow and touch the lives of those around us. We pray this for your glory, in your name.